bit, yep. Like an Alistar, like maybe an Urgot, that's hard to tower dive.
And of course, similarly, you're going to see Edward Gaming, I think, ban a lot of these AHQ mid lane champions from Westor, the Zed going away, things like this, the big individual playmakers. And it surprised me somewhat that AHQ chose blue side for their game two and game four. They're not opting into a counter pick for Westor as much as hoping to get first pick themselves. You're seeing multiple bans come through from EDG. This leads me to think first pick Rek'Sai, get the early aggressive jungle away from Mountain and get clear love on one.
Mountain has been so good at ganking early on, and we saw the kill participation. The analyst desk showed it, how active he is in the early game. If you ban Gragas and first pick the Rek'Sai, he's left to play Jarvan if you look at like the standard picks for him. So with them even banning here, they're respecting clear love as well, who's had a fantastic showing on Rek'Sai.
Kalista pickup as well for Daft wasn't something that continuously was played by him throughout the season, but he showed up all-star status in a 15-1-10 game already up against Fnatic on that. So with that first pick going over, Ziv now looking possibly to Maokai in the top. It's been Maokai Gnar for him, back and forth.
Yeah, we're going to see a lot of Maokai today from him. It's so good to set up these TP ganks with a Maokai where you just TP down to this bottom lane, instantly dive onto a target. Sejuani will be a little bit new for Mountain. Again, I'm sure he's practiced more of these meta champions. You won't have the same impact in the early game, though. That's the big difference. That's right. Why he's still been playing Jarvan here, despite him getting nerfed a few times, just to have some good early ganks.
Yeah, now the thing is to keep in mind with AHQ Esports Club is that even though at this tournament it's all been about their early aggression and the early ganks going in the LMS playoffs, Mountain was 3-0 on the Sejuani. If they do want to go for the teamfight style that even got them here in the first place, these are worthwhile picks up. Sejuani, I think that does get locked in. It's a pick away from Clear Love and the big 5v5 dragon fights that got AHQ here in the first place. Looks like the style.
But EDG is going to get a lot of strong picks. Hecarim would be open for Koro in the top lane into this Maokai here, a matchup we've seen time and time again for himself. And also, Kalista. It's a bit of a weird story with Kalista, because back in LPL, Deft had horrible games on Kalista. It seems like he just played it trying to show maybe force a ban with it by showing I can play it. But at MSI, he's been first picking it. He's been performing well. We have to see if he can do the same against Ant, because he has to expect a lot of pressure coming his way.
We already heard AHQ say kind of 4 games, right? That means the first game is kind of the pitch you look at, make sure you know what the other team is doing and where their aggression is going.
Yeah.
Seems like they're going to get a lot of picks they want on the side of EDG so far. Wait a minute. No. That is a lock-in. That's not a hover. That's a Thresh and a Nautilus now for EDG.
All right, so either it's a massive miscommunication for Edward Gaming or this Nautilus is going somewhere else. Now, I've seen this champion played in like every lane. I've seen top and mid Nautilus, but yeah, I think
I've seen it. I've cried. And now we're going to see it in the jungle, most likely, for them. I think Nautilus jungle is such a risky pick because your early game, I mean, your damage is so, so low for a jungler. So when you get into these early ganks and early skirmishes, all you really offer is a whole lot of CC. The new Nautilus out as well will max his E typically.
Yeah.
So you don't have the W damage you normally had. So I'm not too sure about this one, but it's a team fighting pick.
I actually do think the E damage is fairly high. I have a friend I play rank 5s with a lot who plays a ton of jungle Nautilus, and his actual
defined
damage
fairly high.
Diamond D-Lo. And it's fairly high. I think he has a decent damage output. I put the footprint similar to Sejuani. The engage is a bit slower, granted, but we'll see how it pans out. More engage for the bot lane, though. AHQ is still looking to make team fights happen, and they've still got a lot of playmaking potential in the bot lane as well. Keep in mind, the Twisted Fate of Westor is still left open at this point. This would be, I think, a very likely pick to complement the rest of this team for AHQ here. Yeah. A lot of team fights available.
Really depends on what the mid lane pick will be for EDG, because we know the Fizz is there as well.
Yeah.
Zed was banned away, despite Westor. You know, he played a few times. This is one of the champions he's known for, but Zed is not that great in the current meta. I feel like there's other picks he's had more impact on if you look at the last few weeks, but that's the first ban, obviously, for EDG. Hecarim, I wouldn't be surprised. We talked about it before here. It is such a good pick for Koro because it allows him to be a big carry. And this guy has been so, so good up in the top lane for EDG all split long. And when you run a heavy engage composition like AHQ, it is very easy for the other team to flank on you because you're obviously going to run straight at EDG. So if there's a ward on the side, look for Koro to teleport in, and then you just destroy the enemy AD carry.
That was an 11-0-9 Koro the first time they faced AHQ Esports Club. So I'm sure Ziv wants to get a bit of that revenge back for himself as well. And now what will Westor be able to round out this composition with?
And we can really see EDG here, what they're doing. Cassiopeia as well, yes, okay, you can land a stun on her because she doesn't really have any mobility to escape that. But if you miss it, her ult is going to stop you when you run straight at her. So she can survive fairly well. You can build a few tanky items. You obviously get that tier, you fully stack, you have that extra shield from it. And then you simply buy time with the rest of your lineup. You got the Kalista jumping backwards, you got Box from a Thresh, you got the E obviously from Nautilus, to just kite, and wait for Coral to come in with that teleport, and then you simply collapse on AHQ.
Well, we'll see if they can collapse on AHQ, because it looks like AHQ wants to collapse back onto Edward Gaming as well. Pawn smartly looking at Cleanse right now for a Summoner Spell in the mid lane, but AHQ has a million and a half ways to start team fights out. Honestly, in almost all these lanes right here, Edward Gaming fairly similarly, a lot of engage power, but a gigantic front line for the twin carries of Pawn and Deft to just chunk damage out from back.
And AHQ has so many ways of starting tower dives. They got the tanks who can stand there. They have all the instant CC to lock them down. They have the Twist of Fate porting from the mid lane. They used this early in this tournament here, and Westor would sacrifice his own lane just to keep ganking the top lane where they were trying to shut down a Cassiopeia. He can do the same here in terms of ganking the side lanes and just start tower diving left and right.
Well, the teams have been locked in. There were thoughts that both of these teams would face impedances on the way here, that Ziv had to go to military training and they wouldn't have time to train. Pawn wasn't feeling well. Both teams have overcome anything that was put in front of them and the teams to get here to the semifinals. And now we will see what they have for each other as the champs are locked in and loading onto the Rift. Make sure you head over to Twitter and start sharing your predictions. As always, tweet at LOL Esports and use either hashtag EDGWin or hashtag AHQWin. We'll be checking in periodically to see who you think will advance to the finals. These players are going to have quite a say in that here as we start game one. We're on the Rift.
And everyone's predictions coming into this series were that this was going to be a very bloody set of 3 to 5 games, and Champ Select is going to show us that it's probably going to be exactly what everyone is expecting. I'm glad we've got two people to yell about team fights here. Quickshot probably would have killed himself if he was the only man to yell during team fights in this one. You and me, Riv, going to have a lot of yelling, a lot of champions
picked
out.
I think it's safe to say when Sivir Leona is your bottom lane, it only goes one way, and that's forward for AHQ. And let's look at Mountain as well, because when he's been playing Rek'Sai, he would often do 3 camps, possibly only 1 buff, and then 2 camps beside that, and then just go straight bottom lane and start ganking. Sejuani again, she's going to be weaker in the early game compared to Rek'Sai, which we normally see for him. I wonder if he plays the same style and still just goes for all these early ganks, or we get to see him sit back a little bit more and try and farm.
Well, we'll see which style ends up working out here as the beginning starts come through. You're seeing Anne with a very safe opening. Steelback already took notes on that one. Mountain hopping around. Ziv also with some early safe wards to watch for the invades. Edward Gaming actually all piled into their own jungle. Didn't find an invade happen. Looks like just battle lines and really no actual deep vision for either side, and they're going to have to blind pick their lanes.
Playing it very safe in the start. AHQ is a team that normally doesn't lane swap too much because they want to keep Anne and Albis on the bottom side for some dragon pressure. They play a lot around these dragons here in the early game, and obviously also for this ganking power they can have where you set it up with your support. So they're going to take this lane matchup. It is not an easy one for AHQ. They're going to be pressured a lot in the early game, and they just have to survive until Mountain is ready to start ganking, or maybe Twist of Fate hits level 6.
Keep those wards up. Figure out Clear Love's pathing through the jungle. He's definitely going to try and be in your face, maybe even on this Nautilus early. We will have to see. Bottom side, we see the Gromp's going to be helped, and the Krugs as well to the other side. But no, the lane swap actually came out quite late there. EDG is going to get free side to the top.
So EDG deciding to swap it up top side. I'm not sure they were expecting HQ to be there and just want to try and counter swap it for themselves.
I think it's very likely they didn't come in to freeze the lane. They didn't do Gromp first. EDG just was hoping to dodge all the wards and be like, surprise, we're here. Oh, crap. And AHQ, I think, getting lanes that they would rather have on this one. Thresh grid against Leona, Kalista grid against Sivir.
Really, really good for AHQ then. Not the end of the world for someone like Coral, because he's running Smite on Hecarim. We see, like, the European Hecarims like Huni, who runs Ignite for the more early to mid-game pressure. He likes to go Smite, though, for Coral. It's more the skirmish of Saber, it's a late-game scaling.
Right.
And it does help now in these lane swaps with the double jungling, even when you start doing some camps on your own.
Very nice by Mako, trying to be a little bit troublesome here. See what he can get out of this. Once they tag the red, though, if it goes up, they are going to know of his presence.
Look, and he's already got friends coming in. Exactly. It's going to be 3 versus 2 up in this jungle. Mountain and Ziv going to be there in a very sad party in this one. They know.
There's the hook on to save. This is going to be a fast first blood. Mountain still trying to focus on that red buff as much as he can, hoping it was only a small skirmish. But then two more members of EDG pop out.
Really, really good raid from HQ, though, with Mako moving in to just spot it. He knew that the bottom lane from HQ were on the bottom side, and there wouldn't be enough members to collapse on him. He could even play it safe and just back away in case he had found someone too early. Albus now will be spotted. HQ already swapped into topside to make sure Ziv can get some farm under here, because the wave is already pushing in.
And it's a 2v4. Ziv right now isolated as a 1v3. Mako takes the first turret shot. Early flash from Ziv trying to get away. Koro is low, has no escape. They're going to trade one back, but Ziv will also fall. Both top laners dead. And now Mountain's in a really fast spot. Flashes in, gets some depth with the snipe. 3-1 EDG.
3-1 for EDG, and such a good start from taking that red buff, pushing in the top lane as well, saying, we're gonna stop you from even getting to that tower. Only the Maokai was standing there. You saw Albus, he was already zoned away, so they could take the first kill. Yes, traded one for one, but at least get a second one after. Denied all the farm as well. That's the big deal. This Maokai is being set very far behind already.
And of course, Koro not being set behind at all. He got 2 assists during that one. He's already down in the lane, 1v1ing a Saber, which is not a hard matchup for this Hecarim overall. And meanwhile, a lot of denial, of course, had gone down towards Ziv.
Yeah, because HQ didn't get a freeze in the bottom lane, seeing as they were doing Grump or helping with the Grump, but then walked down to the lane. So he was pushing into the tower. And when you've just seen so many members on top side, you know you can safely teleport down. It's only going to be a one-on-one. And had not managed to bounce the wave on the tower, he's going to try and do it. Now you can see how he just grouped up most of the minions to hit one of them and just try and sit back and see if he can deny something for Koro, but he's already on 18 CS and 2 assists.
And it's left Pawn to hang out mid lane, have fun. 33-20 in that CS against Westor. He's been a little back and forth with the damage and figuring out, should I go top to help the team, should I not? It's been a lot of options for AHQ here to be pulled back and forth in the early part of the game.
And what's so smart as well from EDG is in lane swaps against the likes of a Leona, if you push in the wave, you force her to recall, go up and help the top laner, or go for a dive herself. Because there's no top laner to dive on the bottom lane. She has to go up and help the Maokai, and then she can't roam, which is something she does so well in the early game. So you basically freeze her right there as a melee support. She's not really helping a whole lot when it comes to Ziv and farming. So they completely nullify the early game.
Yeah, sometimes Leona lanes these awkward sort of swap two-on-twos. There's actually a lot of kill pressure there. Old Jax is a really good example of one, just someone who had a ton of damage and the gank pressure was great, but you've got a Sejuani jungle, not a good ganker early game, and Maokai, honestly, pretty low damage threat here. Like, good luck turning this fight around. They're just gonna let Ziv take a bunch of damage. He might even die for this one.
May, the Ren's gonna be there. A few more hits, not gonna be enough in the end, but this is going to be tough for AHQ to get anything they want out normal game or early game normally. They love to do dragons, and that's not even on the chart for the next five or so minutes.
No, they're gonna have to simply move this Luna back to the bottom lane, and then have Mountain come down if they want to take a dragon. Give up that top lane, because it's already lost. You're not gaining anything by staying up there with your support, because you're going to lose the 2v2. Slowly but surely, your tower will go down. And we've already seen Clearlove as well saying, well, I'm winning, or my team is winning mid lane, but winning top lane. I'm just going to walk into your jungle and start placing a few wards, spot everything that's going on, and you won't be able to do anything.
Ever Gaming is crushing this lane swap, absolutely. More hooks come in. Pawn is also winning the 1v1 against Westor. This could nearly be a kill, actually, as the Petrifying Gaze comes out. Westor down to 300-400 health in this one. And just down the line, Edward Gaming absolutely dominating the lane swap from the buff steal early on in the game to the fights afterwards. EDG crushing the early game.
And that's something they absolutely repaired from their playoffs in the LPL.
HQ has to go for a fight.
Turn them down in some of their games.
Wow!
Gets hit up there. Mountain now trying to come in as well to get a little more crowd control on. Elbus has already routed Mako for his escape here. He flashes on. Does he have the Daybreak shield? Good hit by Clearlove to get the passive stun off. It's still a skirmish before the turret, and that means Mako goes down, but Clearlove will make it out.
So what was a horrible situation for AHQ before, where they were simply were losing out in every single lane in this lane swap, quickly turned into 2 kills. I'm not sure how Mako did manage to play back Albus here. It was just Deft staying too far forward, and therefore getting engaged on. Big, big mistake from EDG up there in the top lane. Had they just played it out safely, they would have just gotten stronger and stronger. I mean, compared to two top laners, 45 CS, solo XP from one guy, and a Maokai is trying to share with two other people and barely getting anything.
Well, AHQ is doing what AHQ normally does. Okay, it didn't work the first time. We're going to keep trying to gank this lane over and over again. It seems it's not they're ganking for AMP, but just ganking wherever the enemy AD carry is. And finally, this one works out. They tie up the scoreline and kills, but you see a 1,000 gold difference, yeah, keep in mind, just from this massive disparity in the mid and top lane, yeah, for EDG.
And now AHQ, as we talked about before, what they could do was simply swap the Leona down to this bottom lane and try and have some pressure down here towards the dragon as well. But they're already behind in XP, except for if you look at the 280 carries. Top lane Zip has just hit level 5 for himself.
To me, that's actually okay, though. Level 7, Boomerang Blade, BF Sword. You know, Def got some Berserker's use, but if you're getting stunned, who cares what movement speed you've got? So I think there is some kill pressure if there's an outplay against Mako.
Definitely is in the bottom lane
and
for HQ.
Six.
That should be the focus as well, seeing as Koro is already so far ahead up in this top lane. You can't really expect too much from the Maokai. So yeah, bottom lane is where the kill pressure can be, and that will also lead into this dragon that, yeah, AHQ wants early on.
It is worth pointing out, Death still has his flash on Kalista, saved his summoner spells on his prior death. So this is a very scary lane. Death, if he goes past River, just dies to Twisted Fate, unless there's a really good lantern from Mako. And it's gonna be, you know, up to EDG outplaying. You can see Mako playing towards the back. But one misstep is a kill for AHQ and a dragon afterwards.
So we have seen this before with Rushing Hurricane on Kalista. I've never been a big fan of it because you have great AD ratios, so getting that early BF sword is so, so important for your early trading. This is simply going to be more about having early wave clear and start shuffling out lanes. He's obviously maxing his E, so there will be some damage from the stacks, but he needs quite a lot of them in the early game, and that's very risky trades when there's a Twisted Fate on the map, when there's a teleport from a Maokai who you know likes to go bottom lane. If you have to sit and take long trades with the enemy AD carry, you risk getting killed by these globals.
And it's just about time for that dragon clear love, trying to get in and force this ward out. You can see Mount coming around the side. Don't know if they're going to be able to get much out of this. With the six from Westor, I would have figured the TP bottom would have activated their first dragon attempt, but it looks like the party's going to be in the mid lane. Westor only moves a few thousand units there, and he may get hit up. He's forced right out of the fight immediately. Oh. That's going to be clear love going down. Koro's forced to ult out of the fight there, and EDG actually did not want.
Oh, very good setup from AHQ. Both teams are trying to set up some pings. Might not be over yet. Mako is going in.
Now on very low health. The box comes out as well. The re-engage on the left-hand side towards Pod. Albus just trying to buy time. He will sacrifice himself for the team as Koro, now being chased down, will not take the wild cards. Gambit would be ashamed, but EDG can walk away from this one. 1-1 in kills overall. AHQ burning all their ults for the first one. No fight left in him.
He's got the kill on Clearlock before here. Both teams really trying to get some pink ward control. The ward you saw from AHQ is simply to allow Westor moving from the lane down and then teleport to this bottom lane. You saw the pink just behind the blue buff to make sure no wards would spot him. But that's now going to be cleared out. And EDG has taken full control of this river with their own ward. So they're the ones now who can start looking for picks around the dragon, who can roam from the bottom lane and up and obviously try and spot when this Sejuani is coming. There's only one way for Mountain to really gank now, and that's going to be jumping over this small wall into the river and then go for it. So as long as EDG keeps decent vision there, they should be okay.
Well, prioritizing those mobility boots for Mako. They don't have the double sight stone just yet, but are keeping that vision where they need it so far. 4-4 on the kill score. Just about that 1,000 gold lead still, as we have yet to see a turret or a dragon go down. Pretty incredible to see for both of these teams that love to get those early objectives.
Gonna have to wait for AHQ to get their ultis back,
yeah,
or we might see the next move from them. They're obviously a team in the early game, very ulti dependent on setting up these ganks with the likes of a Twisted Fate. Well, Leona has now hit level 6 for Albus. Mount, yeah, will have his own ready as well.
Well, it's worth pointing out, though, that ultis are not, it looks like, with no teleports up for the top lane, there's that big advantage they've got up for the top lane with Koro.
Sun was in his eyes.
Lot. Yeah, okay. Misses that one. EDG gonna get some control back, but without teleport, the top lane advantage here doesn't really mean too much for team fights, ganks, or dragons.
But what means a lot is these pink wards from EDG in the river. They spotted Mountain coming in there, so they started moving from the lane already before anything even happened. They keep denying vision from AHQ, and they want to contest everything. When you have Cassiopeia in the mid lane, she's so strong in these one-on-one fights, so you can always move from your lane and start fighting them if they want to kill your pings. And it is a Chinese team after all. You don't, yep, kill their pings.
So both teams approaching Dragon, let's put this into perspective. What's the perfect engage from EDG? What are they looking for?
Well, for EDG, really, They don't even need to engage. That's the beautiful part for them. They can wait for HQ to try and start a fight by them popping, you know, Sivir ulti, Leona, everything. And then you disengage back. You have Clint on your Cassiopeia. You're building early magic resist. And you wait for Coral to get a good flank with his TP home guard. And that's how you simply turn the fight around. And AHQ, they just have to be able to lock down one target and focus it. Every single member has to kill that one guy. If we see Cassiopeia, Kalista stay alive, that can be enough for EDG to win the fight.
And speaking of Cassiopeia staying alive, though, just on Tyr and just a Negatron Cloak does not make her durable yet, but Cleanse is just now coming back up. The window where Destiny was up and Cleanse was not, that one's now closed, or the door, if you will. Koro still without teleport, though, right? He's 4-on-4, so I think this is a window that AHQ should use, being that Ziv is so far behind Koro. Koro's got his challenging smite already. He's got the home guard boots. This is this 1.5-minute window where things can happen for AHQ. Solar Flare is back up. All the tools are here. Mountains towards the bot lane.
Yeah.
EDG's warding control is so darn good that they keep spotting him.
Look at the two walls here on the bottom side, one near the Grump and one just around the Tribush behind the tower of AHQ. That's to spot Mountain coming from the only way he really can, unless he's running straight through the lane itself to try and set up a gank. But there's double flash obviously for EDG in the bottom lane. And if you see a Leona randomly firing a ulti right on you, you play it safe and you flash away from it.
And EDG is definitely playing this one for the map control. They do not want to give this first dragon up. They're sitting across their team on just about 5,700 gold in their pockets that they go back and spend between the lanes. 2,500 of that is on their AD carry.
Wow.
It's going to be the kill on Westor. They relieve this pressure. Might be a little bit easier to back and spend all that cash money.
Who needs teleport? We just walked down the river. Meanwhile, team fight on the boss side. Steph gets stunned up. That will be a kill coming towards Anne. Now Mako's got to be careful. Still no TPs available. Not even Destiny with Westor dead, but a 1-for-0. The re-engage forced the flash from Mako. AHQ managed to turn one back around.
And Def dying once again here. Had flash ready. Still managed to get locked down by Albus and Anne. This is very important for AHQ that can keep getting some kills in this bottom lane. We know they like to play around the AD carry in these late game team fights. People talk about how EDG's mid laner is a bit of a distraction. We can say the same for AHQ's because late game team fights, it's Anne's time.
And right now is going to get the first global objective of the game with Dragon 1 on the field. Looks like a bot lane kill was all they needed. Def holding most of the team's kills, most of the team's gold. He's off the map, and EDG not going to be able to fight much of anything. Hurricane plus BF Sword plus almost level 9 for Def will make him very strong, but now there's no team fights to go for EDG.
Let's do this again.
Yeah, let's see what happens. There's obviously so much mobility for EDG's bottom lane already with Kalista jumping around. There is flash as well for Def. So the first one he dodges. And how does he get locked down? Just walks into melee range of Albus, gets stunned, and instantly locked down. Big, big mistake from Def here. All he had to do, honestly, at this point, because they are winning so hard in mid and top lane, was just play safe and sit and farm. Because when you die, that's where you open up a dragon as well for AHQ, and that's exactly what they want.
EDG's also been avoiding Anne's lane. Not avoiding, but going towards the top, going towards Ziv. Now Anne gets a few kills of his own just because of the skirmish in the bottom lane, and he is one of the guys for AHQ, besides Westor, that's going to put the game on his back. Start getting that silver kill.
I mean, in terms of winning team fights and winning dragon fights, I mean, Westor can make the plays, he can start the fights, and he might even get the picks and as a result, win those fights. But in team fight output, it is entirely on Anne's shoulders. If he gets picked off, there is no team fight for AHQ. If he has no gold, there is no team fight for AHQ. Starting the game 1-0-1, starting the game with good CS numbers. Anne's in a good place so far. HQ pretty much playing according to their book, and yet EDG still far ahead from their lane control, from their CS leads.
From the lane swap.
And exactly, that gigantic early game lane swap lead.
They're kind of resting on those leads, if you will.
Well, I mean, keep in mind, they have great scaling in terms of the Cassiopeia and the Hecarim, so EDG is not in a position where they necessarily have to force a lot. Now Mountain, he tried to clear a few wards.
Whoa!
You don't do that.
Pawn just wanted to shout. He was happy about the situation. Fountain looked like he could get out of this one. No,
wow.
The Fangs get into the backside of the boar, and they move Mountains.
We've definitely seen Mountain have a weaker early game impact compared to what we saw when he played Rek'Sai, even when he's picked up Jarvan in the past. He's trying to clear out some of these wards around the mid lane, but you can't do it when you already lost tower, and the Twisted Fate is sitting at the tier 2, trying to wave clear himself. You're on your own here. And the Cassiopeia and Nautilus combo with so much CC and single target damage will take you down every single time.
So as we cross into the mid game, about a 3,000 gold lead for EDG. Dragon or not, this laning phase has been pretty happy for them overall. Pawn, we said maybe it was Deft, who is the big carry, but Pawn right now is having the highest impact and the highest difference between him and his opponent. 40 minion lead right here, despite TF being such a great wave clearer as time goes on. Pawn going to be an absolute crusher in team fights, for lack of a better word. Something that has to be kept in mind. You mentioned Officio, the scaling advantages. I tend to agree. TF is going to take a long time to catch up in terms of damage, but I feel like around four items in, TF starts really destroying people, but that's, of course, a very long way away. There's going to be like a 15-minute window where EDG wins in damage output.
It's not like HQ has a bad scaling themselves. You got the double tank. Even Leona late game is very, very strong, and you got some decent damage. Problem is, how do you stop Coral from just constantly pushing up the top lane? Maybe you can just flash on Deft, though, instead of Coral.
Oh, that was a clutch lantern, but in comes more!
Here comes Westor's in, pulls the card. That's going to be Ann's kill, actually. Mako does make it out alive in that situation. Doesn't have to use any summoners because didn't have them, but very scary as AHQ starts to put their foot down here.
And we talked about how AHQ, they love to gank this bottom lane. When you have to draw in, when you have a Twisted Fate, you set up these ganks effectively.
Yep.
Deft dying three times now. He's been farming okay. He's been picking up a few kills. And very early QSS for him saying, you guys got so much CC. I know I'm going to be one of the targets. You know what? Stuff's right.
He's right.
And you can see in all their builds and summoner spell choices, right? Pawn got cleanse. He's popping it almost every single fight. Westor rushing a Lichbane for more of this. And now Zave looking for a TP flank. Can they get something here?
Yeah, Westor ghosted into this one, so it's just wearing off as he gets into the fight. The team's actually reconsidering this one. Mountain gets hit, but then Ziv goes in. I don't know if they want this on all the same page here for AHQ. EDG recognize that, and they begin to go in. Koro gets one. Actually, that's going to be Pawn picking it up as Koro dives in with the Onslaught of Shadows. And as AHQ sees the fight, they don't want any more of it. Ann's able to pick up a retribution kill there for Ziv, but still back and forth. These guys are neck and neck all the time.
Yeah, HQ just trying to force some fights themselves. EDG had three members around and managed to pick up at least one kill on trading one for one in total. The map is starting to open up. The outer turrets are starting to go down. This mid tower has been down for a few minutes now, and it has given a lot of time for EDG to play around the mid lane, and yet Westor managed to get that one gank on the bottom lane. Unspotted, and got a bot lane tower for it as well.
And now AHQ's big ultis are coming back up for the next team fight with Dragon in a minute. We can watch this fight one more time. Very few ults for AHQ, but they come out okay.
Yeah, so it's 4v3 here. If you look at AHQ, EDG just kiting back. We keep talking about how you can kite, especially also with a Nautilus jungle. He provides so much CC, so much AoE slow. Until you single out one target, they do get him down. Koro will sacrifice himself, and very importantly for AHQ, picks up the kill. So after all is said and done, it is a one-for-one trade. The next objective is gonna have to be this dragon. For AHQ's side, can they create a pick at first? With all this engage, they do run. Let's see what summoners are down. No flash for Deft if they can get onto him, but he has the QSS, we need to remember.
Yeah. Pretty poor target selection for AHQ. The poke not
cleanse as well. It will
either.
Be tough.
Exactly. Picking someone down going to be hard. The slow churn team fight, though, going to be an interesting one to watch. Of course, 1,200 gold sunk into a Quicksilver Sash does kind of lower your damage output as an AD carry. And you got to feel like the two item completion Sivir is actually probably the biggest impact in this coming battle. All ultis up for AHQ. A few summoners down. EDG with a gold lead, but they're going to start dragon first.
So seeing as EDG has no wards around this dragon here, and they know with the QSS and the cleanse, you can't just walk in and expect a fight to happen where you lock down a carry, they wisely just back away. What you need to do then is trade for the dragon for a top tower. You gotta get something when the other team invests four members on one side of the map. You need to be able to get something elsewhere. They are sending two guys top, but it's starting very late for AHQ, so suddenly EDG has now two options. Do we just push the bottom side of the map and say, if you go three top, we take either your bottom tower or your mid tower instead?
Oh, wow! A couple crits in a row, and Pawn's chunk pretty late. And spell shields just enough things to stay alive, but Pawn still has ulti for a coming battle. Westor gonna play wave clear duties, pop the ulti, doesn't
look at
the
TP
off this one.
And the flash gets out of that, goes back with the Onslaught of Shadows, cuts it down, and it looks like Elbis is just going to be there to be a nuisance. Koro is getting help from Clearlove here. Pawn's coming down just on the left side. They still have their bot lane in the bot lane.
This is pretty greedy.
This is going to be tough. Koro under the turret. That's not where he wanted to be. Westor is able to pick up a kill now. Mako in on the Fade's call, and he's thrown backwards. They don't want any more under the turret. And EDG, AHQ, 1-1 there.
Wow, the hardcore dive gave away extra kill. Koro, I think, a bit too bloodthirsty on that one. EDG giving away the kill they had picked up already, but we're seeing Edward Gaming hold on very nicely against his sort of pick composition. Still holding on to the lead, still pushing turrets better.
But second time where Koro does go a little bit too ham and ends up dying after they got the first kill. We saw what EDG wanted to do, okay? You put members on top side. Good. We force something down here. First a few crits in the mid lane and dropping lower than Koro coming in. This is why playing AD carry in the current meta is not always too fun when a big Hecarim rip just dives you and absolutely destroys you in the very end. And Koro could just have backed away right here. You got one kill. Try and get this bot lane tower. It's only Westor defending it. And the rest of EDG decide, no.
We're going to kill Westor.
We need more kills.
And that doesn't go quite as well. Mako missing the hook, going to get thrown in there. Deft, I mean, has plenty of damage output. They could nearly win this fight, but enough tank stats. Westor kites it away well enough. They clear the wave. They get minion control for that, but yeah. A bit hard to dive past undead turrets.
We're going to have to take a look at Deft and the damage he can do in team fights. Building Hurricane against multiple tanks is very, very risky because you don't run any crits, so you don't really have a whole lot of single target damage and you need so many spears to be effective, and it's hard to get enough down on multiple members because one guy's going to try and always zone you out, and that's going to be a problem for Deft if we have these straight-on fights. He will have a lot more wave clear, though, and fast pushing potential.
Yeah, but the Frozen Heart Rush for Ziv, first item after the Catalyst, I mean, it's really going to hurt Deft. Stun's going to land on a Mako. There is a face call, though. You cannot go for the support of a Kalista. It just does not work out. Deft flashing away, of course, himself.
Look at the play. Deft flashing away so he can pull Mako to safety after HQ once again trying to look for these picks here. Not afraid of investing multiple members on one side if they can try and go for something. They are falling further and further behind. Now, another pick may be coming.
What a pile on that Glacial Prison. Locks up three mountains coming up big in this fight. Albus has eyes on Pawn. So does Westor, but they turn it. Clear Love very low as those two go down. Pawn and Mako now not a part of this fight as Clear Love also skirts off down the mid lane. Koro came in but was not able to help from that bottom side of the map here. EDG is starting to lose a bit of ground. And now 10-8 in favor of HQ.
And Baron's alive on the map right now with a Lich Bane Twisted Fate as well as two items in the AD carry. If HQ wanted to be risky, they could go for a big objective like this. But HQ, not a team that cares much about Baron control. They're going to play it much more safely. Okay, I can't complain too much.
It is really great to see, though, AHQ, how ready they are to punish EDG when they feel a little bit too greedy. There was three guys staying fairly far pushed up in the mid lane after you just had to spend flash in top lane, even ulti from Kalista to pull two guys away. And HQ has multiple ways of engaging, not just the Leona ulti. So this is okay, you're staying three guys pushing up. We're going to go for you. Two more kills secured mid tower as well. Every time EDG makes an over-aggressive play on the map, they get punished.
And it's not like EDG has a bunch of disengaging tools. It's mostly just their flashes to get away from fights like these. So, you know, a 2-minute cooldown Zipper ulti versus a 5-minute cooldown flash, at some point these add up to EDG not having a way of getting away from the AHQ hard dive. And AHQ now only down 500 gold, but Edward Gaming going for the Baron Sneak, but it's right on top of a ward. AHQ should be here in time.
This is going to be intense. I think ADG definitely going to pull off and look for the fight.
You don't want to be caught in this Baron pit, though.
They may not. There's the Righteous Glory going in. Mountain dives across. That's actually going to be rendered out by Deft. Baron goes to EDG. Ziv is onto Deft, and he's not going to be able to do much when he throws Mako to Westor. That could finalize him. They both go down, and the Onslaught of Shadows comes through.
Edward Gaming looking to clean up this fight now. Ziv's got no damage left. All the carries are gone. A 4-for-2 fight plus a Baron with a triple kill for Pawn.
And despite AHQ having a ward on the Baron, Kalista Cassiopeia, they destroyed double smite as well. EDG had so many ways of burning down this Baron in time. They got it, won the team fight as well. It could have been so tricky if they were caught in there against all this CC from AHQ, but just never managed to get in time. Albus, he's still running away.
Yeah, I played it.
Where are you going?
Pawn using his time wisely. Quickly heads to the mid lane. Knows everybody's in the ring around the Rosie game right now. After the triple kill, able to pick up a turret as well for himself, sitting on 2,000 gold. Let's see this again.
Yeah, just look how fast EDG can burn down the Baron. And then you have Cleanse on Deft. You have Mikhail's as well for Mako for the next stun coming in. If you look at Westor here, so two stuns now. Not going to call it wasted, but cleansed away at least. And EDG managed to just clean house. Only one of the carries is being targeted. That's Deft at this point. The rest of EDG feeling safe, can win the fight.
Ooh.
And it's fun to watch them because they normally don't care about dragons. EDG is like all about it. We need that one Baron. If you make a mistake, we will grab the Baron instantly, and then we are so good now at pushing our advantage on the map. And that's typically how they win games. Just get such a big lead doing that Baron buff.
And AHQ, one of their fatal flaws is fighting dragons. They should not. 5,000 gold deficit, Baron buff on three people of Edward Gaming, and AHQ happy to stick around. There's a giant wave toppling that could be pushed, but they want to fight for Dragon right here. Edward Gaming going to take it down very soon.
Here comes another Destiny. Deja vu, but on the other side of the map, who's going to take this one? It is going to be Dragon. Deft once again rends it. Ziv is going to pick up Pawn. No triple kill for him this time. And to the back line, and cannot keep himself alive long enough. And it looks like EDG will just start to trample down on the members of AHQ after taking the Dragon and controlling the fight nicely.
And we talked about how EDG, they're not looking to engage. They want AHQ to start
the
fight.
They want to react to it.
Yes, then we back away a little bit, and suddenly Coral just appears from the side, from the flank, and he dives onto someone from HQ in the back line. And that's how you win the fight. There's so many defensive options for EDG to stay alive long enough that at least only one of the characters will go down. Look at this here. EDG kiting backwards at first, Wester even coming down, and then look at the top here, near the blue buff. Koro jumps in from behind, looks at Ann, and he just basically zones him out from the start. We'll probably take him down with Clear Love as well, while the rest of EDG...
He says, I gotta go.
They just keep stands around, and yeah, you can flash the wall, so can Hecklin.
Man, poor Ann right there. He's not just doing the right thing, and it's so impressive how much durability AHQ actually has in this fight. So much time was spent, so many ults burned trying to knock down Pawn, and while they eventually did,
yeah,
it just let the slow burn of what Cassidia had for damage and just death with the Hurricane Bloodthirster just removing people. The Kills Crucible, a big deal, absolutely. The cleanse, everything else, just keeping EDG alive long enough that that hard engage isn't quite killing them.
If you really think of the positioning on that fight, it kind of just turns your brain around. EDG were in the pit, they got Dragon, and then somehow Ann was in the pit, forced in. It, these guys, like you said, able to just kite it out to Fischio and bring the fight into their favor. Throughout the beginning part of the game, it was very neck and neck, but the dominoes would always fall in favor of EDG. They were getting the turrets. They were pushing towards AHQ's base. AHQ's only had that last surge,
yeah,
but it looks like it's been stopped again.
AHQ have managed to get kills when EDG spread out on the map. The last few minutes they've stayed together when they were focusing Baron, Dragon, they were staying as a unit. So when their fight happened, AHQ only managed to take down one of the carries.
Yeah.
It wasn't enough to win the fight. If EDG goes back to splitting up, that's where the Twisted Fate, that's where the Maokai TP will start making, or possibly making plays for AHQ. We can see EDG here, two guys on top side, two guys in the mid lane, so there are now options for AHQ to suddenly go for someone. No cleanse either at the moment. And we go back to grouping.
Yep, and we're gaming. They want to knock down these tier 2 turrets, put a lot of pressure on them. They know they are the stronger team, and so far it's been hard for AHQ to start fights successfully. Top lane tier 2, wave cleared away safely by Saver. That push isn't quite going to work, but it forces Ziv to recall back and go defend the top lane. So split pushing, not really getting a lot done for AHQ. Of course, a split up map would be great for Twisted Fate. Edward Gaming not falling victim to that. They are very cognizant of the team comp they are fighting against. They've done so well to survive all these Twisted Fate ganks from Westdoor. Stay grouped.
Look at the boots upgrade here on a Cassiopeia who doesn't run Ghost because you are forced to go for Cleanse.
Yep.
You now get the 12% speed up instead when you cast an ability to somewhat make up for the lack of Ghost and give you that extra mobility. Kiting potential once again, because it's also a very aggressive build. Going Death Cap when you know so many guys are going to dive onto you. Mm-hmm. No Rylai's coming in yet, no Hourglass.
You have control of the fight, and now this armor they've produced is like you have an AP 80 carry, right? You can just
right.
keep spitting out damage as fast as that guy is. No RNG to worry about, you're doing the damage.
You're relying on your shield and the fact you have
right.
Cleanse and Mikhail's to hopefully
yeah, exactly.
keep you alive.
Wow, he even got Lifesteal, or not Lifesteal, but Spell Vamp.
What is...
And he's not going all the way for Will of the Ancients. I mean, he's just stopping on Revolver here. That could have been a cooldown item afterwards.
Definitely thought that was going to be a faster Void Staff.
Yeah.
But get Spell Vamp.
Merc treads some Spell Vamp. Like, he's probably sitting on the 130 Magicka's or something here for Pawn. 105. I guess when he has an Aegis nearby, it'll be 125. Then I'm close again. But
if you think about it, look at the side of AHQ. They haven't stacked a whole lot of magic resist. No Locket for them. If you look at Mountain in the Jungle, it's gone for Warmox instead, so that's more HP.
Yeah.
You don't really need a Void Staff at this point yet. I mean, there are other items you can get, but honestly, I do think Void Staff would still be the best, just because it is so important in the late game.
Right, right.
But clearly he's valuing getting some Spell Vamp, and maybe, again, a bit more survivability. He knows he's going to be targeted at first.
There's a little bit of beef they have to work with that'll help in the kiting to stay alive. it all works out. And that speed synergy from the Fuhrer boots as well. See if that comes into play big in these ones, if he does have to kite even more. Minute on to Dragon. This game has kind of hit a lull here. Clear Love going with the iron. You can see he's gigantic Nautilus now with that elixir.
Well, you can see what happens when the enemy team is full of amazing wave clear champions. Sivir and Twisted Fate, two of the absolute best in their roles. So turret sieging is honestly a bit of a futile choice here for Edward Gaming. So they're playing the objective game. They've spent the last few minutes prepping this Baron. It's up now. And look at all the wonderful blue wards around the map that lets EDG crush this one. Two smites and a Kalista. I don't care who gets it, someone in EG gonna kill that Baron.
We saw how fast they took it down before, and they didn't hesitate. They just started instantly, despite even having a ward in the pit from AHQ. Wasn't even pinged out by EDG. But yeah, they can't really siege. They can't really split push either, because of all the engage from AHQ. So very tough. It has to be around this Baron here. You get up their Baron buff, you buff up these minions, and then you can maybe get a few hits on a tower, or you have to just force a tower dive straight onto HQ. But that's the risky one with so much CC that it is a bit tricky for EDG closing out the game. They want HQ to move out of the base and take another 5-on-5 team fight. You need a pink there, guys. Normally you would need a pink.
Well, the Destiny is going to be locked in on this one. It's only for Vision at this point. Albus is at the front door of this engagement, and he's going to be the one that's hooked first.
And he's got a lot of armor and MR, but the damage output still coming through from Death. Will there be any kind of re-engage? It's a 1-for-0. Sivrulti popped to go backwards, actually. So much for that lane only going one way. These guys are running for dear life. Clearlove poked down a little bit, but AHQ, no illusions of winning this battle whatsoever.
Yeah.
But they re-engage up on Okoro anyway. Ziv waiting around. This is a 5v4. Keep in mind, there's the dive onto, and he's trying to cut out with the Ruin King, but there's so much pain coming through. Koro can't quite make it happen. Mako flashes, can't reach it. Mount, however, is caught by Pawn.
Ooh.
Ready to deal the damage. Cleanse on up. One hit from Dead Mountain. Barely lives.
We've seen this before happen, where EDG gets an early kill, and then Koro just goes man mode, tries to get
one
something
more.
Else, and he ends up dying. So many low members from AHQ. EDG is back on this Baron here. They still have all the DPS they need. Just missing one smite this time.
It's gonna be easy. It's not even the smiters that have gotten it. Deft has gotten the dragons and the barons. He'll do it again. The rend just too good, and he knows how to use it. Ziv doing what he can to place and clear wards on the way out as he watches the Baron once again go over to EDG. Dragon is alive. AHQ's first love, really. And they're going to try to get that for themselves here to prevent the fifth one from coming any faster for EDG.
That's going to work, actually. Very smart for AHQ. They've gotten a little bit more confident, I guess, as time goes on. There were moves in the SKT game yesterday where AHQ could have taken objectives and took the slow route. This time, smarter plays by AHQ, but still, they're down 9,000 gold. Edward Gaming looking great.
And that's only the second Dragon, 36 minutes in for a team who normally plays around it so well. And that simply comes from losing the mid lane. They couldn't contest the wards around the Dragon. They couldn't put any pressure really from Westor, except for one gank down the bottom lane.
Yeah.
That's been so tough for AHQ in the early game. And also the fact Mountain is not on a ganking champion. With the Sejuani. Sejuani has some decent ganks, but it's, again, it's not the same as these early game junglers like Rek'Sai.
And that's what we were looking at for EDG to do, is target him a little bit with his champion picks coming into this game.
He knew it would be first picked. If HQ didn't ban it, it would have been first pick from EDG. And that's why they decided to ban the wave. But then you got to make the trade here. Do you want the Kalista then and give them the Rek'Sai? I mean, you got to be able, when you're on red side, to value how important is one pick if we can get two super strong picks for it.
Yeah, number two and three. And number two and three here were Sejuani, Maokai. And they thought, okay, we can get Clearlove off of his early game champions. He was a great Lee Sin player, great Rek'Sai player. Those were gone away. He was a great Sejuani player. Remove the team fighters too. Clearlove goes down to Nautilus in the tier list.
Yeah.
And looks all right for him.
It looks really all right for him. Just in the jungle, being harassing early with the entire team, they made sure to make it even harder for Mountain. The Destiny comes in here at the second tier as AHQ looks to stop the push.
Again, they have good wave clear. EDG knows they can't really split up too well, especially when there's no teleport on the side of Koro. So just trying to stay around. They have to buff the minions. They will get at least the first tower down.
Whoa.
Might get an engage.
Great grab onto Ziv. He may have to stay in this one. No, he actually goes Twisted Advance to a minion to flash out. They want the full team to defend the base. There's the hook onto Mountain. Westor is there with a gold card as well, and they are trying to evade this fight by any means.
That's a flash of two ultimates, though, just to disengage from basic ability cooldowns here. I guess Mako boxed, but it's not really that important of a spell right here. EDG still able to keep pushing on. Baron buff still on a few members. AHQ doing what they can to remove wards from over the wall, but Edward Gaming looking to knock down an inhibitor for too long.
Very methodical in their ways this game. Like you said, Officio, really hasn't been many initiations by them, but working off AHQ, trying to get into their face, and actually backing off on this one. Not going to go for the inhibitor turret, so again, playing it safe, a huge wave towards the bottom side of the map has caught their eye.
Carl's already there to push it in, but of course, nice awareness by AHQ to get Westor down there to clear it as well. We are, by the way, at a four-item Twisted Fate. This is the breakpoint where I feel TF starts to do meaningful team fight damage again, so don't be surprised if he chunks out some tanks. It is a champion that I think ADG has to go back to respecting now.
But he's running without Hourglass. So for Westor to dive onto the carries from EDG is so, so risky because they can take him down in a matter of seconds. And the fact, again, they have these cleansers here to get out of his stun makes it hard for him to do a full combo with the wildcards as well. So it's very tricky for Westor to play these team fights. He might have to just sacrifice himself trying to kill someone from EDG. He's going to have to get Hourglass if you really want to dive in.
No, I think right now their plan is kill minion waves as fast as possible. And honestly, tank killing, I guess, is doable. It's a four-item AD carry Sivir with Blade of the Ruin King, so that damage output's actually quite good. And low cooldown wild cards are going to be at 3 seconds at this point. And that's damage output that does matter eventually. Westor, also keep in mind, stack deck is a pretty good ability. TF ends up having some decent damage. It's no Cassiopeia, but a champion I don't want to underrate too terribly much in this game. Either way, Edward Gaming have not gotten a lot done off their two Baron buffs so far. They've not knocked down an inhibitor turret. They've still got bot lane tier 2 to go. And Dragonfire have nowhere in sight either, so bashing their heads against this wave clear team has been difficult for EDG to make progress.
We'll get a few hits on tower here, so just timing the wave. As long as Westor isn't there with Ann, HQ won't be able to instantly clear it. So by him sitting mid, at least the last auto turret is gone for EDG. And they might just look, if they don't feel like they get a good opportunity to potentially get a kill or maybe even a dive if HQ is split up, then they might just wait for another Baron and keep playing around them, hope that HQ is walking out of the base into a 5-on-5 team fight.
Well, HQ really relying on that Destiny, not to get into place, but really show what EDG is doing and how the AHQ can get around them and route them for the fight. Albus picking up the Banshee's Veil now so he can stay alive longer in the initiations here that AHQ wants if they can get the right one.
If you want magic resist as a support, just get a Locket.
Right.
I mean, you might as well buff up the rest
get a Banner
of your team.
Of Command.
Banner of Command.
You've got
as
a Locket
well
from Nautilus, so remove the TF Wave Clear option, promote some minions, make even more pressure for AHQ to deal with.
Really don't like supports going for greedy defensive items for themselves. You're not that important as a support.
Oh, be
and
careful.
Goro, he's important.
He's going for Ann right now. Is the peel going to be strong enough? Burnstone or heal? There's the ulti in as well. Ann getting chunked out by the Cinder Hulk. And another stun comes through the flash of the wall. Koro, though, survives this engage. And in comes the rest of the team, not the cavalry, ironically. But Edward Gaming still pushing through AHQ out of the base. Dragon in 30 seconds. Baron in 1 minute. Map control remains with EDG.
So now, AHQ moved out of the base. We instantly saw what EDG wanted to do. Didn't get any kills for it. So as we mentioned, we might be in for another Baron.
It is a bit cooldown off this field, though. That's the only global TP that Edward Gaming has. Twisted Fate one-shots waves at this point. He is going for Zonya's or Luzon's next, so he's going to get even more scary as time goes on. But AHQ is a team that used to love doing 1-1-3 split pushes, and that's actually a tool they could use the next 5 minutes as EDG takes down Dragon, only number three right now.
And then straight over to the Baron itself for them. And AHQ needs to make a decision here. Do you want to risk being caught in a team fight by trying to stop this Baron? Or do you want to give them another one and just sit back in your base and keep wave clearing? I almost feel like you have to try and take a fight because these buffed up minions are the ones that make it tricky for your Twisted Fate, for your Sivir to constantly clear them out. And that will buy time for EDG to break in the base. But at the same time, if you cannot get the right engage, because you have no wards at the moment, you're just going to have to Twisted Fate ulti for vision. And they're going in for it. They want to fight.
Oh, they put their foot down immediately. Elvis tries to go through. The Zenith Blade misses. They're on to Koro, but he dives back out of the fight.
Oh!
Westor is on the side and Ann's on the back, but they're not able to deliver any damage right now. That Boomerang Blade, however, flying through. Mountain gets the first one. Death's going to pick up a
they're
kill.
They're winning it!
Onto Westor. They are picking up the kills they need. The HP bars of EDG are falling, but a second guess here by Mulligan and may have given EDG the edge on the fight. Pawn is not going to try it again. Koro and Albus back and forth as he cuts down Albus finally. And what a scattered fight. These are going to be lasting forever.
That was absolutely tense. A 10,000 gold deficit. Oh God, Alan's gonna die for this one.
Or they're
and
the
heal
right
from
now.
Koro is gonna be enough. There's the ace on the backside, a 2-0.
Watching Koro play is very, very fun. The Dutch dare on the Sejuani dash. And once again, AHQ, they just pile on so much CC to the backline of EDG, but they couldn't lock down two carries at once.
I don't know if they have the mana for this. Pawn's out and Coral's
yeah, he's completely out of mana.
I don't know if they win this. I really don't.
Come on, Baron. Show us what you can do.
Oh.
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 Oh. Oh.
Oh. I don't think that triggers anything in the store, but it was still pretty awesome.
Good guy, Baron, keeping HQ in the game.
Koro, once again, going to ham.
All right, let's see. Yeah, he has to die every single time. Engage first, cleanse being used. Let's see what the rest of HQ is going to. Can they get onto this back line? There's a beautiful ulti from Mountain onto four members, but they simply can't target out both these carries here in the very end. I believe it is Death going down. He jumps forward very aggressively.
He wants Westor.
Wants Westor down, ends up dying for it. And here, it looked okay for HQ. The Cassiopeia and the Hecarim, though, they're still alive. And in the end, EDG back in the middle and gets the last few kills before Baron joins the fight.
See, after this, I was kind of like, all right, they're just going to kind of farm it out in mid, and Koro's just like, man mode.
Koro has to die every single time.
And he's still dead, so AHQ starting up on a Baron. There is no teleport. This is incredibly risky, but it's a play they're going to make. TP and Destiny
West pop
to
TP
engage
well.
Onto EDG. Indoors pawn they go. Is it going to be enough? The stun lands as well. Seraph's shields will still be down, but a massive re-engage.
Oh, the
spell vamp is so massive, and in comes Koro. It's a 1-0, and out goes AHQ. Three kills going to be picked up for this one.
The Mikhail's right onto Pawn immediately, lets him run rampant. Double kills all around for EDG as Koro finally gets back. I think it's going to be hard for him to die on this one. But it looks like they're actually going to be pushing base.
I like this here. Go for the base because you had so much trouble breaking into it with all the wave clear from AHQ. Open it up now. You have minion waves as well.
They can win.
There's 40 seconds. You might just be able to finish the whole game.
And here they go. Koro's going to be tanking this turret. He is beyond tanky. 30 seconds on the respawn. There's the mini wave. He's even got a cannon. There is no way I feel like Mountain could actually clear this wave properly.
Well,
and here comes
hero.
The game-winning push.
He says, follow me. Come this way, not the Nexus turrets. What a game one from EDG. AHQ said it would be four. They have their chance now. EDG takes game one.
What a great controlled game by Edward Gaming. It is difficult to play against a Twisted Fate as good as Westor,
yeah.
To not get picked off, to maintain your gold lead, even in a big split up game. You don't even have siege potential. And EDG had to play for the dragons,
right.
For the barons, slow and methodical, and they did it.
Two things started the whole thing for EDG. The lane swap was so heavily in their favor. They got very, very far ahead. Koro got free farm down in the bottom lane one-on-one. Then the mid lane pressure where they got down the early tower. They had some good fights defending these wards. Mid game, they were splitting up a few times. HQ really showed what they could do with this combi, how good they are at finding the picks. But then it stopped once EDG decided, now we group, we focus on objectives like Baron, like Dragon, and you have to come team fighters straight on.
I love the early, I would say,